evening, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished members of the panel and members of the legal fraternity. Welcome to the sixth lecture of the Nani Palkhivala birth centenary celebrations. Before we start, I would like to thank our sponsors for the day, LexisNexis, which... which we all know are the market leaders for computer-assisted legal research and publishers of the universal barracks that we so regularly use. Lexis has also insightfully put a stall today with books on Mr. Palkhivala, which are on special discount solely for today, so please do check them out before you disperse for the day. So now we can start and it is indeed my greatest pleasure to invite on stage Mr. Major General Nilendra Kumar, who has been Judge Advocate General for the Indian Army and now stands amongst us as the founder director of Lex Concilium Foundation. Please give a huge round of applause, please.
Honorable Mr. Justice L. Nageswara Rao, Judge, Supreme Court of India, Mr. Tushar Mehta, Solicitor General of India, Mr. Neeraj Kishan Kaul, Senior Advocate, Mr. Chairman Sarkar, distinguished audience here, Mr. Soni Sarabji, former Attorney General, members of the Executive Committee of the Indian Society of International Law, Senior Advocates, Law Officers, the members from the various think tanks and the NGOs, law teachers, students, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all for this lecture. With great joy, we welcome Honorable Mr. Justice L. Nageswara Rao, Judge Supreme Court of India, who is our chief guest today. He has earned wide admiration for his legal acumen, patience and humility, and his career path, especially for the information of my student friends here, shows extreme hard work and eminence after completion of his law degree from the AC College of Law in Guntur, Andhra Pradesh. He had begun his practice in 1984 under Mr. Surya Narayan, a renowned lawyer of Andhra Pradesh High Court. A decade later, he shifted to the Supreme Court and asked the reason why he has chosen to move to Delhi. He said, quote, "If I have to compete with the best in the country, I thought I must be in Delhi." He acquired large fame due to his in-depth knowledge of laws related to excise, arbitration, taxation, apart from constitutional and administrative laws. He was designated as a senior by Andhra Pradesh High Court in the year 2000. And had two stints as additional Solicitor General of India, first in 2003-2004, and thereafter again from 2013-2014. Before his elevation to the Supreme Court, two cases notable, which I'd like to mention before you. One relates to a Jayalalitha's matter for the possession of assets disproportionate, and he was successful in getting the trial court verdict reversed. That resulted in a complete acquittal. And the other matter that he argued brilliantly related in Supreme Court to the NEET matter, where he appeared for the state of Tamil Nadu and the Christian Medical College. He was also a member of the Supreme Court appointed committee that went into the irregularities relating to match fixing, betting, etc. In the Indian Premier League matches, where he was there with Justice Mukul Mudgal and Mr. Nilay Datta. He was elevated and took over as a judge of the Supreme Court on 13th of May 2016. After he has come to Supreme Court, two of his matters, judgments, I would like to remind this audience. The first relates to Abhiram Singh's case, which ruled that the constitution forbids states from mixing religion with politics, and the court held that the religion, race, caste, community or language would not be allowed to play any role in the electoral process. Now indirectly, that matter has a bearing, a linkage to what is the theme of his lecture today, on which the other two speakers will also be speaking. And yet another matter is of one Narendra versus K. Meena. We are sitting with Justice Dave. The court held that a persistent effort on the part of the wife to constrain her husband to be separated from the family constitutes an act of cruelty, which is good enough for grant of divorce. Now, the topic chosen by Justice Rao for today's lecture, as you see on the screen in front of you, is dignity in the constitutional context, a judicial overview. Now, you'd recall that dignity, the term, finds place right in the preamble itself, and subsequently the constitutional provisions, particularly that are there in part 3, they have a direct or indirect bearing to the dignity and even the right to reputation, which has held by the Supreme Court to form part of the right to life, has a linkage with the dignity. And I'd also like to remind that even the UDHR underlines the recognition of the inherent dignity of all members of the human family in the context of foundation of freedom, justice and peace in the world. With that, moving on, we welcome Mr. Tushar Mehta, the senior advocate and Solicitor General of India. He will preside today's function. During his student days, he won various gold medals from Gujarat University and from the Gujarat Law Society. He thereafter was the visiting faculty with the Motilal Nehru Law College and the Vivekanand Law College. He began, set up his practice and began in 1987. 20 years later, he was designated a senior in 2007 by the Gujarat High Court. And the next year, he was appointed the Advocate General of Gujarat. As Advocate General of Gujarat, he represented the state in a number of complex and heavy matters, including Sohrabuddin Sheikh's matter. And then he came as Additional Solicitor General of India in 2014, and in 2018 was appointed as the Solicitor General for India. He's represented the Union in a number of top profile cases. Some of these I would like to mention include 2G scam, ASL Maxis case, challenge to Section 66 of the Information Technology Act, the matters relating to Bhima Koregaon case, the state of Jammu and Kashmir insofar as Article 35A is concerned, which is in hearing before the Supreme Court. We welcome you here, sir. We greet and welcome Mr. Neeraj Kishan Kaul, senior advocate. He holds a degree in law from Delhi University, where he was awarded a gold medal for getting the highest marks in constitutional law. He then went to the prestigious Cambridge University for his master's, started his practicing the same year as Mr. Tushar Mehta in 87. He forayed into various areas of constitutional law, human rights, administrative law, public and private international laws. And his sheer hard work, dedication led to his appointment as standing counsel for the central government in Delhi High Court in 1998 and his designation in 2002 as a senior at the relatively young age of 38. He took oath as the additional judge of High Court of Delhi in 2009, but that was a very short tenure. He has assisted the Supreme Court in as amicus in number of very crucial matters, say for example relating to prevention and cure of dengue, rehabilitation of minor orphan girls, free medical treatment for those hailing from the poor segment in the hospitals. And there is also a long list of very complicated cases where he has appeared in the Supreme Court during all these years. For example, in matters pertaining to Mamata Banerjee, Aadhaar, CBI matters, including the IPR matter, pertaining to the photocopy that pertained to the Delhi University incidents. He was appointed the Additional Solicitor General of India in 2014. Now we are present here as part of the Nani Palkhivala birth centenary celebrations that started on 16th of January this year and will go on to 15th January 2020. The achievements, the role of Mr. Palkhivala, his contribution as a front ranking lawyer in India for over four decades, a reputed jurist, impressionable orator, writer who earned great admiration, a dynamic corporate leader, eminent diplomat, activist and philanthropist, hardly finds any equal. And I would only like to quote about him what Justice H.R. Khanna had said after the review of Keshwanand Bharti matter. And Justice Khanna, H.R. Khanna is said to have said that the level of advocacy to which Nani rose has seldom been equaled and never surpassed in the history of the Supreme Court. Now, some very heavy words. Now, the Palkhivala birth centenary celebration, there is a steering committee headed by Chief Justice Venkat Chalaya as chairman and Mr. T.N. Chaturvedi as working chairman. It has members including Justice Sujata Manohar, former Chief Justice Sadipak Mishra, Mr. Soli Sorabji, we are very fortunate he is present here, Mr. Fali Nariman, Mr. Murli Bandare, Mr. Ashok Desai, Mr. Iqbal Chagla, Mr. Arvind Datar, Mr. P.H. Parikh, the Director, Indian Institute of Public Administration as our ex-officio, and I happen to be the Honorary Secretary. We had a quiz on the Constitution Law to begin with on 3rd February, and that saw participation by 54 teams from some of the top-ranking law colleges in India. And we had Justice Deepak Mishra as the chief guest at that function, carried huge prizes for the winners of that quiz. Now, during the passage of this birth centenary, we will be seeing the release of the 11th edition of Kanga and Palkhivala that's been revised by Mr. Arvind Datar. A book in Hindi, Bemisal Palkhivala, has come. We are requesting for release of a commemorative postage stamp in his memory. And apart from all this, we have a series of lectures every month. That's being done on any matter that related to or where Mr. Palkhivala appeared. We had the first lecture where Honorable Justice Lokur, he gave the lecture. For the second lecture, we had Honorable Mr. Justice Dr. D.Y. Chandrachur. The third lecture was by Honorable Justice Ms. Indu Malhotra. For the fourth, we had former Minister Mr. Arun Shuri. And the fifth lecture recently we had by Professor Upendra Bakshi. So we are on the sixth lecture today. We have the very eminent speakers. We are all eager to listen to him. Before we go for the lecture, I'll very quickly run through a few quotes by Mr. Nani Palkhivala that show his command over the language, his wit, wisdom and humor. Can we have that? Now, a problem avoided turns into a crisis, and the crisis not mastered turns into a disaster further down the road. Next. Facts are stubborn things, and they have the impertinence to stare you in the face. The most underdeveloped territory in every continent of earth is situated between human ears. We have learned to transplant the human heart, but not to transform it. The greatest shortage in India today is of that rare commodity, character. And in a function, Mr. Palkhivala speaking about Chief Justice Mehrchand Mahajan had said, I never found him interrupt a good argument or endure the prolongation of a bad one. At the end of the lecture, the speakers and Justice Rao very kindly agreed to have a slot of 10 minutes for the questions, but the questions must be very brief and they must relate to the topic of lectures today. Thank you.
I would now like to invite Mr. Neeraj Kishan Kaul, Senior Advocate, to please come on stage and share his views.
Justice Nageswara Rao, Mr. Tushar Mehta, General Kumar, Mr. Sorabji, and other distinguished members of the audience. I'm very grateful to the Centenary Committee for having invited me to share my views at this function. Without the overruling of the theory of mutual exclusivity of fundamental rights, the interpretation of right to dignity would not have ever been as simple as it was ultimately made out by the courts through very active judicial activism. And the late Nani Palkhivala gave wings to liberal interpretation of fundamental rights in India. A.K. Gopalan had emphasized, and the majority in A.K. Gopalan had held, that fundamental rights operated in separate compartments and were mutually exclusive, each article enacting a code relating to protecting of a different right. This came to be conclusively overruled in Menaka Gandhi, and the theory of mutual exclusivity was conclusively overruled and concept of golden triangle of 14, 19 and 21 was established in the case. But the seeds for this were sown in the bank nationalization case, which was so ably argued by the late Nani Palkhivala. And in the bank nationalization case, Mr. Palkhivala had argued that the law should be tested on the anvil of all fundamental rights. And accepting that argument, the Supreme Court went on to hold that Part 3 of the Constitution weaves a pattern of guarantees on the texture of basic human rights. There is a common thread running amongst Chapter 3, and the guarantees given in Chapter 3 are all interconnected. And commenting on the contribution and the arguments of the late Nani Palkhivala in bank nationalization case, Mr. Sorabji, in one of his articles, had said that this, to my mind, was Palkhivala's single largest contribution to the development of our constitution by persuading the Supreme Court to remove the distortions that had crept in because of earlier judgments. Now, what is dignity? Dignity is not about just respect. Dignity is our inherent value and worth as human beings. Everyone is born with it. This concept of inherent dignity of the human person has been repeatedly recognized in various international documents, right from the Charter of United Nations in 1945 to the UDHR 1948 and ICCPR of 1966. The Indian courts, also referring to these international documents, have gone on to emphasize that a man is born with, and hence it can neither be conferred nor be taken away by an act of state. Dignity is something that he's born with. And this interpretation has helped in recognizing the inherent right of dignity of various marginalized sections of society. As General Kumar also pointed out, the preamble mentions dignity in the following manner: fraternity assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity of the nation. The other articles also referred to in the judgment in K.S. Puttuswamy's judgment said that reflections of dignity are found in guarantees against arbitrariness, Article 14, the lamps of freedom, Article 19, and in the right of life and personal liberty, Article 21. Some interesting cases which have looked at this, these various facets of dignity, are worth revisiting. In Sunil Batra versus Delhi Administration, while dealing with Section 30, Subclause 2 of the Prisoners Act, and solitary confinement of prisons, of prisoners. The Supreme Court held that fundamental rights do not flee the person as he enters the prison, although they may suffer shrinkage necessitated by incarceration. It was held that punishments in civilized societies must not degrade dignity. After holding that a prisoner has a right to dignity while incarcerated, it was held that an infraction on the rights of a prisoner will be arbitrary under Article 14 if it is dependent on unguided discretion, unreasonable under Article 19 if it is irremediable and unappealable, and unfair under Article 21 if it violates natural justice. In the absence of the overruling of the theory of mutual exclusivity, the present act would have been analyzed from the perspective of Article 21 alone. And as I had said in the remarks, this was one of the great contributions starting from the bank nationalization case and ultimately a conclusive overruling in Menaka Gandhi that the mutual exclusivity was done away with. Another case which followed was the Francis Coralie's case, where the question was that under Section 3 of the Coffee Posa Act, could a detainee who had difficulties in meeting his lawyer or family members, what were the remedies available? The court held that right of a detainee to consult a legal advisor of his choice for any purpose is included in the right to live with dignity. It was held that if any prison regulation or procedure laid down by it regulating the right to have interviews with members of the family and friends is arbitrary or unreasonable, it would be liable to be struck down as invalid as being violative of Article 14 and 21. Then in the NALSA judgment, the gender identity part of the right to dignity was dealt with. And the Supreme Court recognized the persons who fall outside the male and female gender binary. The court interpreted dignity to include diversity in self-expression, which allowed a person to lead a dignified life. It placed one's gender identity within the framework of the fundamental right to dignity. In Shabnam versus Union of India, the Supreme Court was dealing with the case of hurried issuance of death warrants to convicts whose conviction and death sentence had been upheld by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court, by striking the hurried issuance of death warrants, said the right to recognize the dignity of human, the right to dignity was held to extend to death row convicts as well. Court held that once we recognize the dignity of a human being, it does not end with the confirmation of death sentence, but goes beyond and remains valid till such a convict meets his or her destiny. We then have cases of passive euthanasia dealt with in many judgments, ultimately culminating in the Common Cause judgment of 2018. And some very recent interesting judgments coming from various other high courts of the country. For instance, the Tamil Nadu High Court has recently held in the judgment of Arun Kumar versus Shrija versus Inspector General of Registration that a marriage solemnized between a male and a trans woman, both professing Hindu religion, is a valid marriage in terms of Section 5 of the Hindu Marriage Act. The court drew on the NALSA judgment to hold that right to choose gender is within the scope of right to dignity. The court made a very interesting observation that sex and gender are not one in the same. A person's sex is biologically determined at the time of birth, but not gender. Therefore, the court said that the transgender can choose their gender as male or female. Recently, in Mohammed Shaleen's case, who was a remand prisoner under the National Investigating Agencies Act, the issue arose whether he should be allowed to meet his spouse, talk to them, or ailing wife in the hospital. And the court ultimately read down Rule 531, subclause 2 of the Tamil Nadu Prisons Rules, which stated that every interview with a prisoner shall take place in the presence of an experienced prison officer. The court held that this rule would have to be read down as inapplicable during meetings between spouses. These are all examples of how various decisions over the years have continued to enrich the already rich jurisprudence on dignity developed by the courts in India, and this work must continue, and all attacks on dignity of individuals must continue to be thwarted by the judiciary. I'd like to end with just two quotes on how important a dignity or inherent dignity of an individual is. Laura Helen Brand said, "Without dignity, identity is erased." And Nelson Mandela said, "To deny people their human rights is to challenge their very humanity." An interesting two lines from a couplet by Javed Akhtar, and I end. मुझे दुश्मन से भी खुददारी की उम्मीद रहती है, किसी का भी हो सर, कदमों में सर अच्छा नहीं लगता। थैंक यू।
थैंक यू सर फॉर योर डिटेल्ड एनालिसिस। वी वुड नाउ लाइक टू प्ले अ शॉर्ट ऑडियो क्लिप ऑफ अ स्पीच बाय मिस्टर नानी पालखीवाला।
Not be heard before his property is taken away. What is wrong with it? What is the social purpose served by not even hearing it? If you look at some of the cases which come to the High Court and the Supreme Court, you would be amazed how the power of acquisition can be abused. One case which we argued before Mr. Justice Subbarao in 1964 came from Madras, where the government wanted to acquire a plot of land, and the very curious thing was that out of this whole area, certain plots belonging to certain individuals were not acquired, and the rest were all acquired. The Supreme Court struck it down on the ground that this is no real power of acquisition. It has been done in a manner not warranted by the Constitution. These are the type of cases, and this is the mischief which the Constitution sought to prevent. But hereafter, no compensation and no right to be heard. But there is another provision which is even more vicious, and that is in the same 25th Amendment, which I wish was more widely known and widely debated, and that is the Article 31C of the Constitution, which they want to introduce for the first time. This article wants to say this, and mind you, it will become the law unless people are vigilant and are prepared to sacrifice their even their personal liberty for the sake of upholding their Constitution. This new provision is this. The Article 31C, let me put it to you in simple language so that everybody can understand who may not be familiar with the technicalities of the Constitution. If any act of Parliament or any act of the state legislature starts with the words that this act is intended to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy under Article 39, that there should be no concentration of economic power. If these are the opening words of the act, whether passed by Parliament or the state legislature, then no fundamental right will apply. Can you? And this, to my mind, is the utmost in utter contempt for the Constitution. There is no other word for it. It is the ultimate in contempt for the Constitution. What does it mean? Without abridging any of the fundamental rights, without even letting the people know that fundamental rights are gone, any law has only to be passed with these opening words, that this law is intended to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy regarding concentration of economic power. And what is the consequence? No fundamental right shall apply. So suppose you are living in a house, your own house, which your father built with his life savings, and the government wants to take it away. And next to you is a politician who, out of means, not known, not disclosed, and not ascertainable, and not identifiable by any process of reasoning or known sources, has a very fine house which is 10 times more palatial than yours. And if your house is taken away and his house is really more suitable for the purposes which the government wants your house for, your right to equality before the law doesn't apply. So you can't say, look at my neighbor's house, kindly take that, it is much more convenient. Nor can you say, why are you taking mine? What have I done, etc. No, none of the fundamental rights apply at all. Therefore, any law can be passed by Parliament or by the state legislature and no fundamental right, neither to equality before the law, nothing at all. And it has only to start with the words that this is meant to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy. Now the question arises, suppose a man were to go to a court of law and say, this particular law is not intended to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy. In fact, if it is implemented, it can never promote the state policy. Well, that is taken care of by the 25th Amendment. 25th Amendment says nobody shall raise any such question in a court of law. In other words, you cannot go to a court of law and even argue that the law which is intended or purposed to give effect to the, not is intended, people know what the real intentions are, but that what purpose to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy can never give effect to the directive principle. In fact, you might be able to prove logically and objectively that it would defeat the directive principle of the state policy, but you can't raise any such point. No court shall go into the question as to whether the law which purports to give effect to the directive principle of the state policy will in fact give effect to it or not. It's not justiciable. Well, ladies and gentlemen, if you live in a democracy where such a ridiculous proposition can be introduced in Parliament amid acclamations, and people can take it lying down without a debate in the newspaper, without people even on raising their voice in protest, frankly, your basic freedoms are not worth saving. It means this, that hereafter nobody is safe once this 25th Amendment is passed. And the same parliament which wants the right to take away your fundamental rights has told you, as I started by telling you, what it proposes to do as the very first step once you give it the power. And what it proposes to do is to do this for you. And this bill is already introduced in parliament. And
after that enriching speech, I would request Mr. Tushar Mehta, Solicitor General of India, to please address the audience.
My Lord Justice Nageswara Rao, my friend and colleague, Mr. Kaul, Major General Nilendra Kumar, Solicitor Ji, and friends. At the outset, I tender an apology that after having heard Nani Palkhivala, you will have to hear me. There cannot be more cruelty than this. Friends, we are in an era where we do not only count our gross domestic product, but now there is a new concept of counting the gross happiness product, GHP. In Bhutan, it's officially so. In other countries, it is not officially so. But every constitution of any civilized nation provides for the provisions by which the gross happiness of an individual citizen can be protected, maintained, and measured. The happiness index of any individual is directly based on the society which is governed by the constitutional principles which are selected by each society for its own fellow human beings. Right from the beginning of human history, the happiness of a society was dependent on the attainment of justice, equality, liberty, and dignity. Right from the inception, the framers of Indian Constitution were aware of the importance of human dignity and its worthiness. Therefore, along with the founding principles of governance on which the prospecting society can be formed, the framers of the Indian Constitution, as Mr. Kaul and Major Kumar has pointed out, in the preamble itself mentioned that the Constitution seeks to achieve fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual. Part 3 of the provisions, as all of us know, eventually take care of the human dignity of each individual. The roots may be different, the paths may be different, the perceptions may be different, the parameters may be different, but the final ultimate goal of the Constitution is to respect, restore, and maintain the dignity of individuals. Whether you call it right to equality under Article 14, any of the fundamental rights under Article 19, any fundamental right under Article 21, whichever way it is explained by the Honorable Constitutional Courts, it leads to the inevitable conclusion that the basic theme of all fundamental rights to ensure a reasonable living of all human beings with dignity, irrespective of whether he is a citizen of this country or not. Basically, human dignity is connected with the individual life and it's having constitutional jurisprudential value as a fundamental right. The Honorable Supreme Court has time and again emphasized about the importance of dignity as a fundamental right in number of cases. My friend Mr. Neeraj Kishan Kaul has elaborately dealt with the cases, and therefore I would think it appropriate not to duplicate the same cases. But kindly consider the range of our constitutional courts while protecting the dignity of an individual. The Honorable Supreme Court went to the extent of saying that even a woman of loose virtue has a right to dignity, and any invasion on her right would be violative of Article 21 of the Constitution of India. Right from right of a woman of supposedly loose virtue till the person who wants to lay down his life, right to die, the Honorable Supreme Court has considered the dignity to be the fundamental foundation on which the life of every human being must rest. The importance of right to live with dignity has been emphasized. While overruling A.K. Gopalan's case, Mr. Kaul has adverted to it, which was rightly, in Maneka Gandhi's case, turned down. And Maneka Gandhi case is possibly the first case where the new jurisprudence of defining the parameters of fundamental rights and defining right of human dignity commenced. It is essential that going forward, a pedantic or rigid view of the concept of dignity is not adopted. The constitutional fabric promoting dignity has set the stage for a future where every individual can realize their immense potential. Friends, the jurisprudence on right to dignity is not a static jurisprudence. It evolves on a daily basis. It evolves with the evolution of every right-thinking individual's ideas. The moment a new idea is conceived in the mind of any right-thinking individual, a new theory of dignity will come into place. 20 years back, 15 years back, 10 years back, nobody would have imagined that a question may come that even a transgender would have a right of dignity in all its manifestations. But the idea was conceived in the mind of some right-thinking individual, was tested by the Constitutional Court, and the jurisprudence evolved. Merely looking back and reading the judgments on the right of individuals to have dignified life, dignity, may not be sufficient. It is for all of us, all who are connected with the field of law, either as law students, interns, lawyers, judges, to take this jurisprudence forward, to visualize and conceptualize new concepts as to how this manifestation of dignity in an individual can have more and more avenues and more protection from the constitutional courts. It is our responsibility that someone after 10 years can dwell upon some other facets of human dignity which would be decided by the constitutional courts. Friends, all of us are eagerly waiting to hear today's speaker. I never had an opportunity to hear Sri Palkhivala except in one lecture which he used to deliver every year after the union budget. And I was in the audience and I had heard him as a budget speaker, not as a lawyer. But I had an occasion to listen to and brief Honorable Justice Nageswara Rao when he was a counsel. And I can say that it is a very fitting tribute that a person of this legal acumen, with this nobility of soul, will be delivering Nani Palkhivala Memorial Lecture. There cannot be any other fit individual who can do justice to the occasion. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for covering the topic so succinctly. I would now like to invite our chief guest, Honorable Mr. Justice L. Nageswara Rao, to speak to the audience.
Two colleagues in a different capacity, all of us were together as additional Solicitor General. teacher, guide and philosopher, Mr. Solicitor General Neeraj Kumar, ladies and gentlemen and students, I deem it a privilege to be here to speak on the occasion of celebrations of the birth centenary of Nani Palkhivala, a genius and a lawyer par excellence. Instead of my telling you about him, I thought I'll read from the citation that was given when he was presented the Doctor of Laws by the Princeton University in New Jersey. Defender of constitutional liberties, champion of human rights, he has courageously advanced his conviction that expediency in the name of progress at the cost of freedom is no progress at all, but retrogression. Lawyer, teacher, author, and economic developer, he brings to us as Ambassador of India intelligent good humor, experience, and vision for international understanding. Not knowing that Mr. Surabji would be here, I also wrote from an article written by him on Palkhivala. I thought this paragraph is very apt. Mr. Solapji says, there have been lawyers who matched Palkhivala in erudition and legal knowledge. But for sheer advocacy, Palkhivala was unsurpassable. Clarity of thought coupled with precision and elegance of expression, impassioned plea for the cause he espoused in the case, excellent court craft, and an extraordinary ability to think on his legs rendered him an irresistible force and made him sui generis. And now regarding the topic, dignity, I was reading an article written by Palkhivala, Constitution and the Common Man, and this is what he said. The essential purpose of a constitution is to ensure freedom of the individual and the dignity of man, and to put basic human rights out of the reach of the state and of transient politicians in power whose naked juvenile chatter is covered by the fig leaf of demagogic claptrap. When I was reading this article, during the same time I was approached to speak today, and I thought, why not speak on dignity, which was very close to the heart of Nani Palkhivala. And that's how I chose this topic of dignity. You heard Mr. Kaul and the Solicitor General tell you about what dignity is and how dignity has developed over the years and the court's contribution to the development of dignity. Human dignity as a constitutional value is the humanity of each person as a human being. Human dignity can be seen in the background of social, religious, and philosophical lives. But we are today trying to find out what is human dignity in the constitutional context. There are two fundamental constitutional situations. One, dignity as a constitutional value, and two, dignity as a constitutional value as well as a constitutional right. Dignity as a constitutional value can be expressed, dignity as a constitutional value can also be implied. Dignity as a constitutional value have expressly been stated in some constitutions, like the German constitution, where Article 1 starts with by saying that dignity is inviolable. And the German constitution has a provision where this provision cannot be amended. You have the constitution of Spain, which also embeds dignity in the constitution itself as a value. And you have a South African constitution which also speaks of inviolable dignity as a value. So these are constitutions which recognize dignity as a constitutional value. And there are other constitutions like the Bill of Rights of the American Constitution. You have the Canadian Constitution, which also has its Bill of Rights, and our own Constitution, which does not expressly recognize the dignity as a constitutional value. You have heard the speakers who spoke before me tell you about the preamble, where dignity has been mentioned. Preamble, as you all know, as people connected to law, is also part of the constitution of Keshavananda Bharati. And preamble, along with the fundamental rights and the directive principles, forms the trinity of the constitution. And preamble is also taken into account not only for the interpretation of statutes which are made under the constitution, but for interpretation of the constitution as well. And apart from the mention in the preamble, there are directive principles which mention about the dignity. Article 39 refers to dignity, especially 39F. And Article 51, which is a fundamental duty, also refers to dignity of woman. And if you read the entire Article 39, it refers to the dignity of an individual from A to F. Though it's not expressly covered as a constitutional right, it is definitely recognized as a constitutional value in the Indian Constitution. What if there is a conflict between two values of human dignity? How is it that they are going to be solved? Arun Barak refers to this dignity as a mother right. And he says all other rights pertaining to freedom of expression, liberty, movement, association are all daughter rights. And then he says you look into them as a basket right, as they refer to in the German constitution. If you have a basket of rights, there's no question of any conflict between a right which is specifically mentioned and a value which is the value of human dignity. And there cannot be a conflict between a mother right and a daughter right. How is it that you read this value into a constitution? There can be an explicit reading into the constitution of this dignity as a constitutional value by taking into account the background in which the constitution is made. You look into the history of the society, and then you look into the constitution as a whole for the purpose of finding out whether there are other external sources for you to come to a conclusion that human dignity is a value that is accepted by the constitution. And an internal reading of the constitution also, which is an implicit reading of the constitution where you say that human dignity is a constitutional value. If it is a constitutional value, whether it takes into its fold all other fundamental rights which have been specifically mentioned in the constitution, and how do you read human dignity into the constitution would be the next question. If this is the underlying right, human dignity is the underlying right, all other rights would be falling within this underlying right. As and when you interpret, say in India, Article 14, you're looking at some problem which comes to court and there's a complaint of violation of an Article 14 or an Article 19 or Article 21. Whenever you're looking at those rights which have been specifically mentioned, the human value of dignity is also taken into account. How is it all started? Let us go back and then look at a judgment which was a dissenting judgment of Justice Field in Mann versus Illinois. It was actually a property right case where the warehouse of the person who went to court was acquired, and then there was a dispute pertaining to compensation. And the majority held that the compensation that was paid cannot be said to be meager. The warehouse that was built can be used by the public, and the government has an imminent interest in acquisition of the property, no complaint can be made about the acquisition and the compensation that was made. Justice Field, while dissenting, said that the life of a man is not mere animal existence. It is something more than animal existence. This is what was followed by Justice Bhagavati in a case which was mentioned by Mr. Kaul pertaining to the rights of persons who were detained in custody, saying that the life of an individual is something more than animal existence is what was taken into account, and dignity was recognized as a part of the fundamental rights that are there in our constitution. Going a little back, before 1944, when Mann versus Illinois was decided, there was another case where dignity was used in the judgment by Justice Murphy in his dissent again in a case which is called Korematsu versus US. Korematsu was a Japanese who was living in the Bay Area in California, which was declared to be an exclusive military zone, and then he was asked to get out of the area in view of the war. He was a person who was born in US, and he said that I have a right to stay here where my house is, and you cannot ask me to get out of this place. But the majority held that in a case of emergency, he has to be shifted, but the dissent held that there was a right of dignity for Korematsu to stay in the area where his house was situated. And dignity was used by Justice Murphy when he wrote this dissent. And thereafter, there were so many judgments of the US Supreme Court, and these were religiously followed by our case from Khadak Singh onwards, where those judgments have been referred to for the purpose of holding that a person's dignity cannot be violated. He has a right of dignity, which is a value, which is actually covering all the other fundamental rights, and that is inviolable. Though it's not there in the Constitution, by interpretation, the court has said that it is inviolable. Why is it that we are dealing with dignity, which is not a constitutional right? It's only because it is not a right as such in India, but it is a value. And where does this value come from? It actually comes from Kant's philosophy, where he defines dignity as a quality of intrinsic absolute value above any price, and thus excluding any equivalence. And as this fundamental value is what underlies the Constitution, dignity is referred to as a tuning fork or key according to which the rights are harmonized. And dignity being a very important facet of a human individual, how is it the law has developed in various areas? I will refer to a few areas which have not been discussed by my friends when they were speaking. Torture, police custody, these were referred to by Mr. Kaul. Sunil Batra was referred to by him. Insofar as death penalty is concerned, he referred to Justice Sikri's judgment where he said that every individual till he meets his maker has a right of dignity which has to be protected. I will refer to a death penalty case which came before the South African court. In a case which is Makwanyane, the Supreme Court held that death penalty itself is invalid and it is violative of the human dignity of an individual, unlike in India, where we say that the right is there in an individual which has to be taken care of till he meets his maker. And in respect of treatment of prisoners in jails, in Prop versus Dulles, where a person was tied to a pole for about 7 hours, not being even permitted to go to a washroom, he went to court and then complained of violation of human dignity. And the US Supreme Court held that his treatment was in violation of the 8th Amendment. And the theme of the 8th Amendment is that there should not be any excess penalties by keeping in mind that there is a dignity of every human being which has to be protected. And in so far as an equivalent to Sunil Batra is concerned, there is a case which was decided by the German Constitutional Court, which is called Daschner. In this case, a law graduate kidnapped an 11-year-old boy and he was demanding a ransom. The police authorities who were investigating the crime were apprehending that the victim might be starving. 3 days already passed and they did not know in what situation the boy was. So they threatened Dashna. They said that unless you give us some information, we are going to bash you. You are going to suffer a lot of pain. Thereafter, he revealed, they found that the boy was dead and the kidnapper was convicted. But on his complaint, there was a case registered against the chief police inspector and the other inspectors who were working under him for having threatened the accused of physical pain to get some information from him. The court said that this can't happen. And even the police officers were found to have violated the human dignity of the accused and they were also punished. So this is to what extent the court has gone to protect human dignity, even taking into account the status of the person who has violated it in the discharge of his duties. I was also thinking about another case when I was talking to you about how courts have reacted to the human dignity and how it is to be protected when it comes to conflict of rights, which I have mentioned earlier. There is a provision in the Air Safety Act in Germany which gives power to the Air Force to shoot down a plane in which there are persons who have hijacked the plane. There are passengers in the plane, but the Act gives power to the Air Force to shoot down the plane in larger public interest because hijackers are there in the plane. A question arose as to whether the lives of the persons in the plane are not important and whether a blanket order can be passed by the government under the Air Safety Act to shoot down the plane because they don't want these hijackers to escape in any event. The court held in favor of those passengers and their lives by saying that their lives are important and human dignity was explained in respect of each individual who was traveling in the flight, and they struck down the provision of the Act. And there's another case coming from the same country in respect of persons who are disabled. There is this game of dwarf tossing, and the government found that this dwarf tossing is demeaning to these dwarfs, and they said we don't permit this because this affects the dignity of the dwarfs. It should not be permitted. But the dwarfs themselves were left unemployed. They went to court and then they said that see, the question of our livelihood comes in, forget about the dignity, you will have to live. But the court didn't accept what the dwarfs said. They said, no, we cannot permit your dignity to be taken away. You can't be tossed like this in public. And there's another case from the continent where peeping is permitted to see a woman dance naked or half naked, where the question of their dignity came, whether the peep shows have to be permitted. That also was held to be bad. So they said that this also affects the dignity of persons. But there is a complaint by them saying that we don't have a problem and we are doing it for our livelihood. So how is it the courts decide as and when there is a conflict like this between dignity of a particular individual or individuals and other individuals who say that, oh, there's something else, some other right which is at stake. So this is why dignity was placed at a higher level than the other rights. In the recent judgment Justice Chandrachud said that an individual's dignity is superior to mob morality. This is what he said. I think it is in Sabarimala case. So there are conflicts that would come in about rights that are asserted, which are guaranteed by the Constitution, and the right of dignity, which is asserted by an individual or a group of individuals. And then the judges would be facing this difficult task of deciding which has to be given prominence. How do the judges decide these cases? In my experience and from what I read, judges do not decide cases on the basis of their whims and fancies. Judges decide cases on the basis of their understanding of the fundamental principles of law, and they also look into the evolving human standards in the society and then apply the law to the society, which is strictly in accordance with law. Now, there are some problem areas as to whether a judge is confronted with a situation where there is a conflict in interest. And in that situation, if at all, the human dignity is also involved, they might lean in favor of human dignity. The judgments of this court, especially the judgment of right to privacy, is applauded all over the world. The judgment which was delivered declaring Article 377 of the Indian Penal Code as unconstitutional has received great applause. Especially the court trying to protect the fundamental rights of individuals. We heard from the audio clip of Mr. Palkhivala, where he was speaking about the fundamental rights of individuals, which are very important. And from the paragraph of his article, which I read out to you, as to how close this rights of individuals is to his heart. Fundamental rights of individuals have to be protected by the judges. In any case, wherever somebody comes and then complains of a violation of a right to dignity, the Constitutional Court would definitely respond in his favor. I end by referring to what Justice Learned Hand said on liberty. He said, liberty lies in the hearts of men and women. When it dies there, no constitution, no law, no court can save it. No constitution, no law, no court can even do much to help it. Let us apply this to personal, the dignity, human dignity also. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I'm sure everybody takes something meaningful back for them today.
After this brilliant presentation by our chief guest today, Honorable Justice Rao, we have time now, very short time available, a window for questions. Any questions? There are volunteers, please write down. Introduce yourself. Please go to Commander Batra there. In the meanwhile, we have a question from Chaturvedi AOR, that's addressed to Mr. Kaul. Can majoritarian view impact dignity of an individual? So I directed it to Neeraj Kishan Kaul.
As I think Justice Rao answered that in the judgment of Justice Chandrachud, that an individual dignity must prevail over mob morality. And I think that answers your question.
We have another question. Please go to Commander Batra there. In the meanwhile, Pranjal, his question is, this directed at the chief guest, Justice Rao, should the right of dignity also need to be respected during emergency, national emergency, external aggression? Because weight of dignity is too vast.
The reference to the judgment of the U.S. Supreme Court in Korematsu, and then even there was another judgment, I thought there was no point in adding judgments. Then there was another judgment of the US Supreme Court, Hirabayashi. During the World War, this was exactly the problem that arose before the US Supreme Court. As to in situations of emergency, there can be a case where somebody can say that my right to dignity is being affected. But the court held that it can be. I was referring only to your the dissenting judgment saying that you can't in any event. Let us take case of a situation in India, where during the emergency situations or situations where somebody has committed any wrong, can he still assert that he has a right of dignity? That has been dealt with even in case of convicts, though not a state of emergency, a person who has committed a wrong, we still say that he has a right of dignity. A person even who is going to die, we say that till he dies, his dignity has to be protected. And even in his death, there should be dignity, is what we have said. I think this can't be a right which can be compromised, at least that's my view.
Sir,
please be brief.
Absolutely, sir. Sir, I have personally heard the lecture of Mr. Palkhivala when he came to National Defense Services Staff College and about teaching the service officers about the Constitution. He said, democracy is meant for the few, of the few, by the few. And that's all I know about the Constitution, sir. Secondly, sir, is there any difference between dignity and izzat? Can izzat be abridged by the Constitution or the Defense Forces? Thank you, sir.
Reputation is a part of a dignity. Reputation cannot be divorced from a dignity. Immanuel Kant says, living well is an attribute of dignity. He says that every person should realize his value in the society, and then he should also realize his goals, and he should also realize why he is living and achieve those goals. The reputation of a person is taken very seriously, especially in the continent. Even in their constitutions, it is written that the reputation of a person is part of dignity. The Spanish constitution refers to reputation also as part of dignity. And in India also, when you speak of reputation, when you speak of dignity, reputation is also part of dignity. I don't think it is not part of dignity.
So two very brief questions. One is by Vignesh, the first year law student, addressed to the chief guest. He says, is it right to suggest that right to dignity requires material provisions in addition to recognizing rights?
There are dignity comes in two parts. One is in a positive way and the other is the negative manner. The obligation that is imposed on the government, that is a positive obligation to provide all facilities, has been taken to be human dignity. While interpreting the 14th Amendment of the United States Constitution, the Supreme Court has held more than once that provision of basic facilities for decent living of a man is part of dignity. Our Constitution guarantees rights like health, primary education, livelihood, etc. This is the positive mandate of dignity provided in the Constitution, which are material sources which are referred to here. And apart from that, dignity being seen on the negative line is this: limitations being imposed on the right of dignity. The government has a right to impose certain limitations, not taking away the dignity as a whole. So a person has a right under our Constitution to ask the government to provide for those resources which are guaranteed under the Constitution.
And the last question addressed, this is also to our chief guest, from Rajiv Manja, says that if marriage is a part of dignity, will LGBTQ community also be entitled to marital rights?
That's what we have held. And that's what the entire world believes in. Marital rights are definitely part of privacy, and this is on the basis of human dignity. If you see the judgment in, of the US Supreme Court in Griswold versus Connecticut, Justice Douglas says that human dignity and liberty are there in the penumbra of the First Amendment of the Constitution. Likewise, human dignity is all pervasive. It runs through all the fundamental rights that are guaranteed under the Constitution, and all rights that are available to any person are available to transgenders.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful session. I would now like to invite Advocate Ms. Harshita to give a token of her appreciation to Honorable Mr. Justice L. Nageswara Rao. Advocate Ms. Priyashri to Mr. Tushar Mehta, Solicitor General. Advocate Ms. Nazar to Mr. Neeraj Kishan Kaul, Senior Advocate. I would now like to invite Advocate Mr. Chen Sarkar, co-founding partner of the law firm Kia LLP, to deliver a vote of thanks.
An ignited mind is the most powerful weapon on the earth, above the earth, and under the earth. And this one gets through education. Honorable Chief Guest, Justice L. Nageswara Rao, Solicitor General of India, Mr. Tushar Mehta, distinguished guest, Mr. Neeraj Kishan Kaul, Major General Nirendra Kumar, Honorary Secretary Nani Palkhivala, Birth Centenary Celebrations Committee, distinguished guests and my dear friends. It is my immense pleasure and honor to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of the entire team of the Nani Palkhivala Birth Centenary Celebrations Committee. First and foremost, I would like to thank our Honorable Chief Guest, Justice L. Nageswara Rao, for taking out time from his busy schedule on a Wednesday and also enlighten us with his views on the topic. It is always a pleasure appearing before your lordship, and today it was a pleasure listening to the vast knowledge of your lordship in the said subject matter. I would also like to extend my heartfelt thanks to Mr. Tushar Mehta, Solicitor General of India. We all know how busy you always keep with your non-stop appearances before different courtrooms in the Supreme Court every day. And we thank you for taking your time from your extremely busy schedule today. It is not only a learning experience to watch you argue in the court, but it is also an educationally enriching experience to listen to you speak on the topic of the day. I would further extend my heartfelt gratitude to our distinguished guest, Mr. Neeraj Kishan Kaul, for also taking out time from his demanding schedule and grace the occasion with his valuable knowledge on today's topic. Sir, your expertise in law is well known amongst all the lawyers in this room. And today, listening to your views has also been extremely enriching. I would also like to extend my heartfelt and sincere thanks to my teacher and also the Honorary Secretary of the Nani Palkhivala Birth Centenary Celebration Steering Committee, Ms. Major General Nilendra Kumar, for being the pillar and also the brain behind this entire event. Being associated with you is in itself a great journey and experience. You have always been an inspiration and a great motivator over the years, and it is always a great honor to work with you. Last but not the least, I would like to thank all the distinguished guests, colleagues, seniors, and my dear friends for gracing this occasion with their presence. I would now like to end this session with a quote by none other than the great Nani Palkhivala, and I quote, "When the law comes into conflict with the basic forces of human nature, the law is engaged in a losing struggle. It is like the Vietnam War, which cannot be won. It is a strong war, fought against the wrong enemy and the wrong weapons on the wrong battlefield." I unquote. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chen. Thank you, all of you. I would now request our distinguished panel members to please proceed for tea right after a quick photo session. Thank you. Please be seated.